friends, have them come to that course and learn about Flipgrid. I couldn't even imagine teaching with any device in any classroom while not using Flipgrid. So we're going to head back over here. So now that you know that, let's talk a second about the why. So in our classrooms, using these devices are Generation Z learners. And it's really important because these kids, if we really think about it, are kids who don't know that there wasn't Google, who don't know that there wasn't, oh, I might have to mute someone. Give me a second. Let me just see if I can mute all of you. I'm going to mute you all if you want to ask a question later. And then I'm going to make sure that you can hear me. Can someone tell me, can you hear me? I want to make sure I didn't mute me. Okay, perfect. Thank you. So anyway, so these are kids who don't know that there wasn't Google, and they do not know that there was life before even a laptop. And many of us know life before this, but they don't know that. And they are kids, if we look at this graphic, who are born into a world with smartphones, tablets, and computers. They are as much tech savvy as they are tech dependent. And I really think it's our job to help them with that savviness, if we are in fact savvy. They're born social entrepreneurs. They don't stand for the status quo. We see that a lot with kids like the one in the Scandinavian, I forget her name, but who's just like, no, climate change is happening and I'm going to do something about it. And they're born into an information revolution. Artificial intelligence will be a big, big thing when they graduate. And so we know that life is going to be completely different when they come out the other end in like 2030. And so we're preparing them for things. And we've always said this, that we don't know, but this is a little bit bigger because artificial intelligence, as Kai-Fu Lee, who wrote AI Superpowers, says that artificial intelligence will be so big, it'll be the difference by the time we get to 2030 between having electricity and not having electricity. That's the massive amount of change that we're going to see over the next decade. Another big thinker out there named Peter Diamandis, he says that we're only seeing 1% of the change right now. We're maybe at like 1.5% of the change we're going to see in the next decade. So it's really important that we understand we don't have these devices like Chromebooks and iPads and Surface tablets in our classrooms so that we can do old school stuff. We want to rethink what we do. And we've talked about this in some of the other sessions, but I'm going to keep reiterating the whole making thinking visible. But let's keep looking at Gen Z. Their social circle is global. It's easier for them to gain an audience. They talk in images and Jiffies and Snapchats and now TikToks. And this is who they are, and this is what their life is going to be like, and they prefer hands-on learning. But more importantly, as we give them devices, we're the crafters of the learning that happens in the classroom. So we're going to approach this session like we have the others, in looking at how do we use technology to make student thinking visible. And this is the best way, Flipgrid. It is absolutely, like, I love Seesaw too, and I love some of the other apps, but Flipgrid just gives me this really quick and easy way to be able to make student thinking visible, to get inside their heads and know when they know something and know when they don't. And also student voice. And by this particular student voice, I mean in hearing from all of them in under 2 minutes in something like Flipgrid, so that I know where every student is. And we often talk about differentiating instruction. You can't differentiate instruction if you don't know where the student is in the learning journey. And I know, true teacher confession, I used to differentiate instruction based on what I thought the learning was happening, based on how I watched them comprehend things or things they did in class. But I didn't truly know where they were in the learning journey until I got devices. And then I could access that information quickly. And then when we allow them to share their work on Flipgrid, they can see each other's videos and they can learn from each other and say, huh, interesting way of saying that. I hadn't thought of it. And that puts them into a place of metacognition and thinking about thinking. So if you've been to other sessions of mine, you've heard me talk about this, but I just want to reiterate it. I'm going to come back over for just a quick second, make sure we don't have any questions. Looks like we got, oh, nice job, Jennifer. Thank you. Oh, and thanks also for the, okay, perfect. I see a lot of yeses there. Oh yeah, you can get a certificate of attendance at the end, and I'll allow 20-minute window from the time I stop to the time I run the script, and then they'll send them all out to you. And then I won't. Then I'll turn it off because I don't want like people coming, calling their friend and being like, get a certificate, even though I don't know if it'll work for your school district or not, but hopefully. Okay, back. So we're going to look at kind of this other framework that I've been working on, and I don't know what happened to the yellow lines on top and around, but it's okay, that I've been working on with the Infused Classroom Student. And
excuse me, I'm not seeing a PowerPoint. I'm sorry. Are we supposed to be seeing something?
Yeah.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure.
Thank you for telling me. I hope you haven't all been like, so when I was talking about Gen Z, did you all not see that?
No.
Okay. Thank you for turning on. Okay, so let me go back and I'll show you the, gosh, just watching me talk must have been kind of boring. Give me 1 second. And then come on and tell me that you see it, because this is where I won't be able to see you. I wondered why I could see you in my tab. Okay, now. All right, can you see that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So let me see something really quick. If you can see that, can I still see you? Now, when I go back, can you see the PowerPoint again?
We can see the PowerPoint currently.
Yes.
Okay, so this was Gen Z that I was talking about. So I'll give you a second to look at that, or if you have the slides, and I apologize, thank you so much. And so this is a graphic to remind you who these learners are. Here's the Making Thinking Visible that we want to do with this technology, the student voice, the sharing of the work. And then here is the graphic that I'm talking about around the Infused Classroom Student. So I've said this before, and I feel bad sometimes because I don't know who's been to what sessions, but as we get these devices, whether they're iPads or Surface tablets or Chromebooks, whatever they are, we need to ask ourselves, not what we can do with the technology, but what can the students do? And so this is, part of what we're looking at, we want kids to be able to explore and question, which they can do in Flipgrid. We want them to understand and track their learning journey, which they can do in Flipgrid. I don't really do this a lot, which is apply and demonstrate knowledge a lot in Flipgrid, but I do reflect. And maybe I'll have them turn in their final project in Flipgrid and tell me what they're thinking, but that is, pretty much what I'll, the only thing I'll do. So let's head over to Flipgrid. And I'm just gonna give you, since this is an intro course, just kind of a basic understanding of what it looks like. So this is a grid. And this is from when Flipgrid first came out and my students, and you'll notice they didn't have all of those, which you will see if you see anyone's Flipgrids anywhere, they have emojis over their face, which you're gonna see with my kids in a minute too. But for me, I turn off those emojis at first to get them comfortable with being on camera. Because if I don't, they'll stay behind the camera and always behind the emojis. And I want them to get confident in talking and telling me about their learning. So one of you has your mic still on, which I appreciate, but if you could mute yourself, we can all hear it pretty good.
Sorry. And,
no, it's okay. You helped me. So, okay. So I'm going to head to Flipgrid, and this is, I should have had you keep it on because when I head over here, I want to make sure that you can see this. So can someone unmute themselves and tell me, can you see this?
Yes.
Okay. Thanks. So this is that actual grid from back in the early times. And I use this one because I want you to see something important here. So these are my students answering a question. So I'm doing an assessment of prior knowledge. So I'm using great pedagogy, something we should always do. And then I'm using Flipgrid to accomplish that. And we're going to head over to Julia. And even on the free course, I'm going to use this example. So if you do go to the free course, you can kind of skip this same example. But I'm asking them something. We're about to read the book Wonder. And I want to know what they know about bullying, because in this particular fifth grade class, we were doing something that had a through line. And I'm not sure if you have used through lines before, but they're sort of like a big level essential question for your class. And this through line was about bullying, because in fifth grade in the U.S., we've got to do some reading. We learn about U.S. history, which happens to have a lot of through lines about bullying in it. And so we decided that we would use this through line. And when we talked about science, we would talk about bullying, and we would find a way, which worked out actually really well. And in order to find out what they knew before we started reading the book Wonder, I wanted to hear their ideas about bullying. So I asked a question, and I want you to listen to this little girl who's explaining bullying, but I want you to listen for one word. She says a word that really helps me understand where she is in the learning journey around bullying. So I'm going to play this.
Get bullied all around the world. And when kids get bullied, they get discouraged and they feel bad about themselves. And it can affect them for their whole lives. If you ever see someone bullying, you should stop them. You should be an upstander, not a bystander. It will really help them.
So I'm going to come back over. And in the chat, did you hear the word? And if you did, what word do you think it is?
Discouraged.
Oh, someone has their thing. Nice. Yes. Okay. So upstander. When a 9-year-old tells you about being an upstander, you know that these kids have had some prior learning, some prior work around bullying. Now, what I haven't told you is this was my teaching engagement at a Jewish school. And so, of course, they've talked about bystanders and upstanders. And so coming into this and reading the book Wonder, I had an idea of where they were. And the rest of the kids, if I go back to the particular grid, most all of them say as well something about being an upstander and a bystander. And so I was like, okay, I don't have to really deal with that that kind of vocabulary with them. But I want you to see this next video. This is Drew. I love this girl. And this is her response to Julia.
Julia, beautiful job. Also, I love your title. That's actually what got me into it. Also, you're very pretty face. Also, you did a really good job because you got me the description, what bullying is and how bullying is wrong. It's a great job.
So you can tell, hopefully, that I work with these kids a lot around commenting. I don't just put them on Flipgrid and be like, I hope you comment good. What we did before going on to Flipgrid, we had whiteboard desks. And I said, if I said something like this to you, what would your comment be? And they wrote it on their whiteboard desks. And then we looked around at each other's and we said, what could we add to that to make it more meaningful? And so before we even jumped into Flipgrid, we talked about proper commenting. And that's why you see her be like, say, you very pretty in face, you're da 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 da. She has a few things to say, and it's not just, Julia, I really liked your response, which I see from kids all the time who didn't do the pre-work. So it's really important in this process of using Flipgrid that we think about the pre-work. But Drew came up to me the next day and said, Ms. Clark, can you take down my video? And I was like, oh my gosh, why? And she said, I said also 3 times. And I was like, oh, interesting. No, sorry, because I'm going to use it because I love your video. But but thank you for noticing that. And then I was working with another class that was in the 8th grade at that school. And a kid came up to me, same exact kind of thing, said, Ms. Clark, I just did my Flipgrid response. I was watching it. I said, all the time. Can I re-record? And I was like, oh, this is not bad. These kids are learning how to be articulate. And I always say this. And then it happened. I went to a high school class, you know, maybe that week or something. And one of the kids came up to me and said, Ms. Clark, will you take my video down? I notice I say like in every sentence. And I was like, oh, I have changed the world. These kids are not going to be saying like now. But that's more jokey. I mean, it really happened. But the point is being articulate and being able to express yourself in really well-formulated and detailed sentences and being able to do it not just by writing is a skill that I don't think we develop enough in school. And if you look at life, we spend 80% of our time talking and we spend about 20% writing, and it's probably mostly in email, which are smaller chunks of information. But when we go to school, we ask kids to write everything all the time, write, write, write. But, you know, if they get to a job interview someday, they're not going to sit at that desk at the job interview and be like, hold on, let me write that down. Oh, and let me cross out that word and change another word. That's not going to happen. They're going to need to be able to be articulate thinkers that can think on their feet and do these elevator pitch kind of things. And so beyond getting at their thinking, we are helping to create kids who are life ready. And I think that's really important. So I'm going to show you some other ones, but I'm going to come over. So like people are talking about what they learned in speech classes. And I always think back to fourth grade. My teacher called me Motor Mouth. It was in the 80s or I don't know, maybe even before. And today she'd be fired for like kind of doing that in to a kid. But if I think back and now know what I do, like that's what I'm going to end up doing for a living, Miss Teacher, is I'm going to be a speaker. So maybe I should be talking. And we just did not really, I'm searching for words because this woman didn't let me talk. No, just kidding. But we didn't really appreciate kids articulating things. And I want to go now into cognitive science of being able to articulate. So cognitive science tells us that students need to be able to struggle with information. They need to like work through it and have to struggle with that information to take it with them. When we give them a multiple choice question and we ask them to pick from four answer choices, there's not as much cognitive struggle. Like if we were looking at a difficulty scale, there's probably like 20%, depending on what it is. If it's some, you know, calculus problem, maybe something different. But if I'm asking you, which literary device is this, an onomatopoeia, whatever, picking from those four answer choices does not allow for cognitive struggle. But coming on to Flipgrid and explaining in your own words and giving an example of an onomatopoeia is cognitive struggle. And you will see kids, I know I have it off, sorry. Thank you. I'll go back over here so you can see pictures. Anyway, and I forgot what I was saying, but if we give them that opportunity to speak, there's that cognitive struggle. We're also allowing them to articulate their thoughts so that we can now differentiate instruction because we know where they are in the learning journey. And so all of this is, these are just really important things. And if you've been with me in other sessions and if you come to any others, you're going to hear me use the term press record. I get really upset when I hear people say, oh, look at this great template. Look at this great thing I can do. And I'm like, great. This is fantastic. I love this. But when the student fills it out, now I need them to press record and tell me their thinking, the thinking that went on when they made that thing. So all of these things are great ideas, but they lack real cognitive science when we don't press record. And we're not pressing record in classrooms because as students, our teachers never asked us to press record, so we don't think to do it. It's the one change that you can make to level up instruction in your classrooms. And guess what has a press record button? Flipgrid. So I'm going to show you another example. This is one of my faves because it's a math problem that this teacher is doing based around Joe Buller's idea that we need to talk more about math. And I like die for Joel Buller. Everything she says is what I think. So she's just putting it into words. And this person had this teacher had a math problem that said a mountain climber ascends 800 feet per hour from his original position. After 6 hours, his final position is 11,600 feet above sea level. Find the climber's original position. So we could go into a whole happy hour diatribe about how boring this particular math problem is, but it is what it is. And now we're going to get at the student thinking. So this is early on again with Flipgrid. And so this teacher had them go on and explain their thinking. And I just need to find Zoe. Where did she go? There she is.
My final answer was 6,800. I got this by multiplying 800 by 6. My final answer from that was 4,800. Then I subtracted that by 11,000.
So whether or not it's one of the most boring math problems alive, she's explaining her thinking. And it's not rocket science, but it's giving us an opportunity to see where she might have gone wrong, to see what her thinking is. And now in Flipgrid, and it has been this way for a while, you can use a whiteboard. So she could have done this on a whiteboard and then explained her thinking as she went along. So what we're going to do right now is I'm going to actually, and I don't know if this will work, we're going to try it. I want you to come to Flipgrid and we're going to try something together. So first let me go there. And I am going to, hopefully you can still see where I am. And I'm just going to log in and go to it. So I'm going to ask you to go to flipgrid.com. And I'll talk, and maybe you just go to another tab. And when you get there, when you get to flipgrid.com, it's going to look like this. And many of you have been to Flipgrid probably. But underneath the fold, underneath this big thing, it's going to ask you to enter a flip code. And I want you to enter infused 2020. And when you do that, it's going to take you to this particular grid. And this one takes you to would you rather right at first, but I'm going to have you use the drop down menu so you can see what happens. I'm going to come over to the chat while you do that. And for any people who are just joining, we're talking about Flipgrid. It's an intro session. So if you know Flipgrid well, it might be too basic for you. And we're heading over to Flipgrid really quickly. And you're going to flipgrid.com and joining Infuse 2020. So let me put that right here. The code is Infuse 2020. Now, I'm going to come back and I'm going to show you how to use Flipgrid, and then I'm going to ask you to actually try it out. And if you have, and if you don't want to show your face because maybe I'm getting my hair done today, which is really a big thrill for me. But if you, you know, don't have, you can use the emoji. We don't have to see your face, but I would love just to have you try this. So let me head over to Flipgrid. This is my grid. My grid is called Infuse Classroom. These are my topics. So the topics, if I click on the arrow, you can see all of the different topics here. And I want you to go to the one called To My First Year Teacher Self. And there are a lot of people on here already from all over the world. And when you get to this topic, you can see that up here I have the prompt. So the prompt is, what would you go back and tell your first year teacher self? Right underneath here is a little button that's immersive reader. An immersive reader is a Microsoft tool that will read this to students. So I'm going to show you what it looks like. Now, if I hide this, I have to hide it.
Okay. What would you go back and tell your first year teacher self?
So for kids who need access to that information or maybe need to translate it, which they can do into a different language, whatever they need, they can get that from Immersive Reader inside of Flipgrid. Now let me show you the Shorts camera. So I'm going to actually log in with Google. Sorry, Microsoft. And here is the camera. You're going to see my face. But what's really interesting about this is that kids can use this whiteboard. And so I'm going to click on this, and it's not going to. So here's the white. And if I wanted, I could be doing a math problem while I'm recording, which is great. And that gets turned in. But I'm actually going to clear this, and I'm going to get out of that. And I didn't have to do that X out. I didn't mean to do that. But I can also just record using this record button right here. I can add text. So maybe I'm going to be talking about Pony Boy at the church fire. If you are not an outsider fan, no big deal, but this is just what I taught for so many years. So I'm using this. And so I can have like this up so you know what I'm going to be talking about. And I can also go bring in emojis and put those stickers. So maybe it's a little bit sad, the church fire. So I'm going to put this emoji up. Or I can bring in a picture. I can do all kinds of things. And I do that by going to these three dots. And I can bring in a screen recording. I can add a video clip. So another video clip of something, which is really cool. Or I can add, just record with just audio. But with this video clip, I can bring that in and upload it from somewhere else. So maybe I record this in Snapchat or TikTok. I can bring it in. But I can also upload images right here. So if I wanted to, let me just scroll over. I'll grab an image of my beautiful little dog. Oh, it's not the right type. I don't want you to see how bad my my thing is right now. My desktop is really busy because I'm doing a book. So it's let me just grab a picture of me. Sorry. Oh, it's not doing it for some reason. Oh, it's doing video. Sorry about that. My bad. So I have to choose. Wait. They just changed this. Where's my picture one? Here it is. So the sticker is actually your image. So there's my dog after all. And so I could have that image of something I made, like maybe it is a paper I'm turning in, and I take a picture of it and I put it on the screen and say, teacher, this is my paper that I wrote. Here are the things I want you to know about the writing process. I worked really hard on the second paragraph, and I'm so proud of that, but I really need your feedback on the third paragraph. So as I turned this in, I wanted you to know that about this paper. And a lot of teachers aren't doing things like that. It's really, really kind of cool and neat. When I press record, and this is what my students do. When they do press record, they do this. Hello, good to have you here today. Was hoping you'd stop by. Oh, hold on, I have a phone call. They get really creative like that. And hopefully you can all see me right now. So that's how they record. I go to next. I can edit.
They do this.
We're not going to edit. And then I have to take a selfie that becomes the cover of my book, of my response. So I do a selfie. Yay. You know who doesn't like selfies? Women over 40. But you know who likes selfies? Kids. So take a selfie. And yeah, that's why we don't. And it gets turned in. So I'm going to come back over. And many of you have done that, and that's okay. And you're helping each other. Yay. And Anna joined the meeting. So Anna is a Flipgrid aficionado extraordinaire and works at Flipgrid. So she's also here to hopefully answer questions, if that's really her. I hope it is. So now I want you just to take a moment and try recording something. And just answer, what would you tell your first year teacher self? And I'm going to be honest with you. I'm not going to watch any of them. So don't worry. Play. Try some things. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put on some music for 5 minutes and let you just play inside of Flipgrid. Come back and ask any questions that you would like. And Anne is here. Sorry, I said Anna. I don't know why I did that. And Anne and I are here to answer any questions. I'm so lucky to have her on this call, and so are you all. So so just play, and I'll put on some music. If I can get my Spotify open.
I promise that you'll never find another like me. I know that I'm a handful, baby. No, I never think before I talk. You're the kind of guy that ladies
Yes, Infuse 2020, but it goes together. And you do click the green, big green plus button to record yourself, yes. Use the drop-down menu to find the one that says to my first year teacher self, because I have five or six topics on there. And I want you to experience what that's like to have to find that. Then you'll have to sign in so that it's privacy mandated, so it's private. Well, there's a lot of people on this. Oh, wait, and Jornay is here. Oh, my gosh. Jornay doesn't know that I was in her room the other day on Facebook and saw her backyard.
Hi, Holly.
Hi, I'm so glad you guys are here. Thanks.
Yeah, learning right along with you.
Yep, I know. You really need this bad. So for those of you playing, Jornay and Anne work at Flipgrid. So that's how lucky we are. And two of the best people you'll ever meet.
You're so sweet, Holly.
So about 2 minutes left, just keep playing. Feel free to submit your video, but you can see there's at least 100 or 150 on there. So you're going to get lost in the crowd, so you don't have to worry. Now, I noticed some people just joining, and right now we are practicing on Flipgrid. We're going to be done in about 2 minutes, so you can just join into the conversation as we finish. Aw, thanks, Anne. So Christine says you found the topic question, but I'm not sure how to record my response. So if you see the question and you go down just a tiny bit, you're going to see a big green add button. My Catholic schools I work with like to call that a cross. But either way, that's where you just start the process. So about a minute, and Anne has added more information on adding a response. It replays the question. Not sure. So Christine, hang right here. I'm going to go over and just show you really quick. So here I am. Oops, that's my other one. Sorry. So here's the Infuse classroom. I did this drop down thing to get to the topic. I think So I looked for my first year of teacher self, which I was already there. I go down here and I hit the green add button. And this is what should come up. Then when you record, let me just record for a second. This might be what you're talking about. I go to, I'm done. I go to next.
This might be.
And now I hit next again. And I get to this place where I leave a selfie. Hello. And then I go to next. And then I can submit it. I think that the title is really important. But that's in our kind of getting bigger with Flipgrid coming up. So that's how I hope that helped. Oh, look. I see me some Anne. Oh, I see some of you. Nice to see your faces. Thanks, y'all. Okay, so I'm going to turn off Tay Tay. and we're going to talk a little bit more about this. So like I said at the beginning of the session, this is just intro, and this is just getting us into what is Flipgrid. There are going to be other sessions that I do on how to make a grid and how to do it with your class and how to it. But one thing I do want you to know, and you might have noticed this when you went to the Flipgrid site, they're going to be having a Flipgrid Live, I believe June 29th, and you guys can correct me if I'm wrong. And Flipgrid Live is where they announce all of the new updates. And every time they have one, it is the most amazing updates ever. And you're going to want to be in the know. So one of the things to sign up for, which I did today, is sign up for Flipgrid Live. You can watch it from home. It's always entertaining, always good. And so you're going to want to be part of that as you do this journey. Now, if you want to know, like right now, how to make a grid, you can go to that free online course that we talked about at the beginning of the session, and you can learn all of the important things. And then by the time that Flipgrid Live gets here and they tell you about the updates, you'll know what they're talking about. So really important. Oh, there we go. And we have Anne just added the link to register for that. So highly recommend, one of my favorite events of the entire year. So now I want to show you something else that I did with some kids, just to give you an idea of where you can go with this and why it is you probably want to take the free online course as well. So this is an example that I just did right before we went into lockdown. And this, we were going to be doing a unit on cells. And what I wanted to be able to do is grab the students, what they knew about cells from the beginning. Then we took this Flipgrid video and we put it inside. I have messages coming across my screen. I should probably tell her I'm presenting right now. So we asked them with the cell unit to tell us what they know about cells before we started. And then we took this video and downloaded it, which I'm going to show. I mean, you'll learn in the course, but we downloaded it and put it into Book Creator so that I had their, what they knew at the beginning. Then all along the way, we did these things and we learned about cells and we talked about them inside of Book Creator on Flipgrid. And then we kept those artifacts in one place. And by the, we were going to, at the end, we were going to look at where they started and then where they ended, and grade that journey of the beginning and the end, rather than grading each kid as if they were all the same 30 kids. And it's really something beautiful to see, to be able to see one kid's growth as an individual. But this is what we asked about cells, and here's an example of what we did.
Of everything around us. They can also be germs and viruses that are inside of us. They're also like, there can be white blood cells, there can be blood cells, there can be photosynthesis cells. But I've never really actually gone into detail with cells.
So what we would hope is at the end, when I have them do a brain dump about everything you know about cells now that we've done this, she would be able to say, well, there's organelles, there's, you know, like all of these things. And I would be able to see at the beginning, she said, I know some things, that's where viruses start. And I know there's photosynthesis, but she didn't say that it's for plant cells. And I could look at her growth over time. And that's why we have devices, so that we can do really rich learning in this way. So once you get really good at doing this, this is a high school example. I like to always show one from every grade level. This high school example is a teacher talking about the Renaissance and Reformation. And she used something called ChatterPix. Now, these kids are high schoolers, so on their phone, because they were actually Chromebook school, on their phone, they went onto the Flipgrid, or they went onto their phone and used something called ChatterPix, picked a character, and made them talk like this one.
Hello, my name is William Shakespeare. I was born and raised in Stratford-upon-Avon.
Now, they use ChatterPix. They draw a line across the mouth, and then they dictate, you know, obviously what Shakespeare says. Then they take that video and they upload it the way that I was doing that before. So let's go back over here really quickly into, I have a lot of tabs open, which is always my problem. And when we go to this plus, this is where I can upload that ChatterPix video, and all of this stuff you can learn in the free course. If you're like, I want to get started right now. But if I want to upload the video, I would just from my phone upload it into here and then place it onto Flipgrid. So there's so many things that you can do with Flipgrid and why it's so powerful. And honestly, it's probably the most viral education tool I've ever seen. So what I'm going to do right now is head back over to our presentation, tell you a few things, and it's going to take a second. It's not wanting to move. There we go. We already did the Flipgrid challenge. I made this not too long ago for leaving those good video responses like we saw earlier on. And this actually was made by my students in seventh grade. We got together, we powwowed, we talked about what worked and what didn't. And they came up with these 8 ways that you can make better video responses. And so I hope that helps as you move forward in trying to use Flipgrid with your students. And I'm not going to be able to talk about all of this stuff, but you can scroll through some of this and see what can happen in Flipgrid. But one of the things I want to talk about, because it's my absolute favorite, is something on Flipgrid called Grid Pals. So I'm going to head back over to Flipgrid and show you this. If I go up, this is my dashboard. And remember, we're not talking about how to make things. That's in later videos that I'll be doing or sessions. But you can learn it all on the online course. But up at the top, we have my grids, and this shows all, well, this doesn't show my grids, actually. This shows all of my grids. They go on and on. You can tell I love me some Flipgrid. I can make a mixtape, which we're not going to talk about, but I have the option to do grid pals with people. So think about pen pals, but putting kids together on a grid. And all of these places where you see a green plus button are all the people who want to interact with you. So if I scroll out and I have a light on me, so I can, it'll start to populate. And let's say I'm doing something about the Middle East and I want to have a grid pal from the Middle East, I can click over here. And if I wanted to interact with some people in Saudi Arabia or Iran, I could, and I could have those kids teach each other things. And because of the great translation tools now available, that those videos could even be translated. So Grid Pals is something that I use to read the book Wonder with fifth graders. And we read it with 36 other classes from around the world, including South Africa. And to see how kids responded to the type of bullying that was happening was eye-opening for me as a human being, but certainly as a teacher, and my students were amazed at how different people looked at different things. And so that was a really, really cool way to get kids interested in the reading process. So I'm going to head back to the top, and I'm going to give you this code again, which is infuse.link/. It should be, oh, I'm on the wrong one. Sorry. I went to my Google Slide version, Flipgrid 2. And if you get to this, and since we are coming to the end, if you go to the end and you look at this, if you fill out the PD hours for 20 minutes, I'll give you to fill it out. In 20 minutes, I'll run the script and you'll get a PD certificate to your mailbox. Also, there's more information like about Infused Classroom and stuff and some other ideas for leaving comments. So you can just scroll through that. But what I want to do is come back, stop sharing, have my video on, and allow for any people who might want to ask questions. And there I am. So if you want, you can do one of two things. You can ask a question in the chat, and or you can unmute yourself and ask a question. We have 6 minutes. I'll wait for that. If you're done and you've got what you need, that's great. I just want to lead you to the online course that's free, or I'm going to be doing more Flipgrid sessions. And there are other people in this Global EdTech Academy that are also doing them. So just go ahead and look them up. And here is, I'll put it right here. Here is the link for the slides. Hopefully that will work. You might want to try, and if not, I can find another way to get it to you. Oh, nice. Thank you, Lauren.
Hi, Holly. It's Andrea.
Hi.
Hey. So you said something really quickly earlier about like kind of training your kids to use the camera. We've kind of noticed since we did like emergency online teaching in the last couple months, since all of a sudden schools were closed, that as time has gone by, we're seeing like more and more like emojis in boxes as opposed to kids' faces. So my fear is when we go back in the fall and we know it's not going to be like traditional, right? Like, I'm kind of thinking like, how do you, I guess, present that to kids and even parents and families, like the expectation of like, we're interacting, we need to see each other. Like, I really, that's important to me. And so I would just kind of like to get your take on that.
So I don't have an end all, and Anne and Jornay can talk about this, but this is how I approach it. I sometimes turn off the sticker option, which you can do under the topics kind of dashboard. And I sort of force it. If a kid comes to me and says, Ms. Clark, I'm just not comfortable, I feel better behind, I let them do that. If they're really shy, I often, or not often, but I have made them their own grid. So the kids don't even notice that they haven't responded. And I see their stuff on their own grid where they feel like, I have some kids who are learning English for the first time and they feel really shy about talking. So they have their own private grid. And I don't make it a known thing. They just think, oh, that he didn't respond. They have no idea I have this secret little deal going on with them. And so I approach it that way. But I also would, if it were me and we came back to school and we did have that face-to-face time, at least for, you know, one day, I would talk to the kids and say, why is it important that we see your face? And let them come up with the idea, and then they'll buy into it more. That's how I would approach it. I don't know if that's right or wrong. If anyone else wants to jump in and offer something, that would be great.
Yeah. Hey, Holly, it's Ann Cosma here.
Yay!
Hey, friends. I was just going to hop in and say, too, I was a first grade teacher for a long, long time. And then I supported K-8 in my district with the innovative use of technology. And I would say these are one of those critical conversations that you as educators have with your learning community, and you set up expectations. I love what Holly just said about, especially in a remote situation, a smile goes so much. But with respect to student privacy, if students are not comfortable, I would be respectful of that also. Set up your own grid, as Holly mentioned. And I'm actually looking for a link right now. I thought I had it in a Wakelet collection, but we see educators who create really cool infographics about expectations and what is a requirement for a response. So if that's something that works for your community, you could set up something like that. You could leave a video as your topic focus, as an exemplar or an expectation. I've seen teachers put in a shorts video of their rubric criteria for how students will either be graded for a response. So many possibilities and so much flexibility, but have that conversation with your students so they know what's an appropriate expectation, if you will. That's just my two cents.
Yeah, as soon as you ask them, they're going to be like, oh no, that's right, we should show each other. But they've got to be part of that. They've got to own that.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I got to go hang up and go to Zoom with my class, but I was very so much more. So thank you. Bye-bye.
So I see one about online, I mean, high school, and high school does, I've seen some issues with them where some of the kids don't want to leave their faces, but this isn't what this is about. It says students create screencasts for their assessments. I had several of my high school students' parents say they were not comfortable with their child's image video on the internet. yes, I've heard this before. Is there any way that they can do the Flipgrid and download it versus uploading to the internet? So I'd have to understand more about this because the screen, it's not on the internet. It's very private. It's behind a very, very password protected. Microsoft is very good about this. So it's not on the internet. And I think that maybe getting that information out to students that this is private, no one can find it, you can't accidentally come upon this grid. If they are uncomfortable with their student's face being shown with the other students' faces,
is she frozen on anybody else's screen?
I believe so. This is Lauren. That's the question I had asked.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, yeah, she is
frozen.
Okay. Holly, so I'm just going to hop into it until she comes back. This is one of those great questions that you as the educator always remain in control of who has access to the content. So if you were to head to Flipgrid or help.flipgrid.com and type in the word privacy, you're going to see a ton of resources that just talk about different privacy features and the way that you can use them as well. Additionally, one thing that if you're not familiar, the topic moderation feature, which keeps videos private and not publicly posted on a grid. Hey, Holly, you froze on like everybody's screen. So we just hopped in and started talking.
Hey, God, you were there. You know what? I think it's telling you like it wants to stop, but we're still here. That's fine. I'm good with it.
Yeah, I'm bouncing to a different, we have another one starting on Flipgrid, but thanks for sharing, and it's so awesome to connect with you all. But Lauren, just to wrap that up, head over to help.flipgrid.com and type in privacy, and you're going to see a ton of everything that Holly was talking about, just features you can choose to use to keep everything private. Holly, you rock.
You rock.
Okay, I'll see you, Lauren. Bye.
So K3 is using Flipgrid in amazing ways, but as people leave, I'm going to stop the recording, but